Thank you, Anthony, for joining us. To begin, in terms of hedge funds, as you know, the overall performance of hedge funds has lagged the market in recent years. CalPERS, the largest pension fund in the country, made headlines by saying we're getting out of this. What is that a sign of? Either the hedge fund industry is going away and is only sustained because there's nothing else around with the Fed suppressing interest rates, or is this a sign of the bottom? When a big one gets out, does that mean this is the time to get in?
All right, so the questions are going to get easier or harder from here. I mean, that was a good start, Steve. But the short answer is that there's a lot of reasons why the industry's underperformed. The main one has to do with something you often talk about, which is Federal Reserve monetary policy. So the policy since March of 2009 has been to hammer down the rates, artificially stimulate the market. This makes it impossible for about 40% of the hedge fund managers to perform. If you look at the overall hedge fund manager index, 40% of it is in long short managers. And so if you're long something, you're doing great in this market, but I gotta tell you something, Steve, if you're short something, even if you're right on the security analytics, you're gonna be wrong on the momentum of the market. And so what's happened to the long short managers is the longs are going up, the shorts are going up, and they have this little tight spread. They're making 3%, 4%, 5% when the market's rip-roaring and the media is writing all these nasty articles about them. But there are places to make money. There's structured credit, activism. There's a whole host of distressed guys that have done well over the last 6 years. But I think the media has been justified in pointing out that, in general, the hedge funds have not done well. The CalPERS thing is a little different. They only had 1.5% of their assets there. Joe Deere, who was a legendary guy at CalPERS, when he passed, I think it became one of those things where they weren't going to get bigger for political reasons, and so they decided to get way smaller. But I don't think it's the death knell of the industry yet. In fact, I'll make a prediction that we'll look back 2 or 3 years from now and say that they caught the bottom of the hedge fund performance market.
You said that they picked the wrong hedge fund managers.
Yeah.
How do you pick the right ones? It's fine to say, well, if you look at the top 10%, you would have done nifty.
Yeah.
But like top 10% of stocks, how do you do it on a consistent basis?
Okay, so it's a lot, not to use a baseball analogy, but just think of it this way.
I'm a fan.
Okay, so, well, you'll probably know this from the Bill James abstracts. 60% of the everyday players are batting 260 or below, yet every midsummer classic we see 40 guys on the field that are Hall of Famers or, the top of what they do. And I think that's indicative of most industries, frankly, whether it's the media, the hedge fund industry, or, political landscape and so forth. And so there are certain metrics that you can use to identify who is going to do well. But the number one metric is the macro environment. If you tell us what the economic dashboard looks like over the next 12 to 18 months, we have pretty high capabilities on the prediction side of what sectors are going to do well. As an example, 2009, if you and I were having this conversation, I would have told you that the residential mortgage-backed security market was going to do very, very well. Those assets were distressed. They were technically oversold by the large institutions. The Federal Reserve monetary policy at that time, with Helicopter Ben bringing things down so aggressively, that was going to be an easy place to make money. And so if you looked at SkyBridge at that period of time, we had about 45% of our assets there. So the first factor is the macroeconomic factor. The second factor then is, once you've figured out what sector you're going to be in, who are the best guys in that sector and why are they the best? And frankly, a lot of them will be different depending on different markets. Some guys are longer than others. They'll always be longer. Lee Cooperman is an example of that. If you're a bull on the market, Lee's a good bet. So it's that sort of thing.
So how do you answer Burton Malkiel and others who say everything always trends to the mean? You can have a good surge upward, but it always comes down to the middle.
Well, listen, I mean, we've all read his classic. I've given it to my two sons to read. I think he's got some brilliant insights, but I think I would take Buffett's view that there are a lot of market anomalies. And one thing I say to students is that there are rational things that an individual will do that are irrational in the marketplace. Again, I'm going to go back to the mortgage-backed security market. We had the subprime crisis back in 2008. We don't call those things subprime anymore. Now we're calling the stuff credit-sensitive mortgages. It's Wall Street's classic thing. We blow somebody up, and so then we rename it. It's like the air the AirTran used to be ValueJet. When it crashed in the Everglades, they changed the name and people are boarding those planes, not recognizing it. But in that specific situation, with the mortgages going down like that, every institutional investor, every CIO, for personal rational reasons, were selling those. They didn't want to go to that February meeting in 2009 with their balance sheet snapshot at December 31st, 2008 with those subprime mortgages. And so where I would question Mr. Malkiel is that what often does happen is irrational things take place in the market for personal rational reasons. I'm the CEO of that institution. I want to look good to my board. I'm selling indiscriminately all of those assets. And so where hedge funds can be very opportunistic, they can step into that situation. The activists are doing that right now, Steve.
We'll touch on that in a moment and your insight about what Dodd-Frank did in that whole sphere.
Yeah, sure.
You're a fund of funds, so to speak.
Yeah.
And you know the rap, hedge funds, 2%, 20%.
Sure.
Now your fees, even 1.5%, whatever it is, on top of that.
Yeah.
How do you justify your existence?
Well, you know, listen, I mean, we're up there with child molesters with most people, so I got a hard time justifying my existence at times. But I tell people the same thing that I think you would tell them if you were in my seat. Focus on net performance. If you're worried about fees, well, then you certainly shouldn't be in the hedge fund industry. But I think what we've proven, if you look at our long-term track record, we can help clients get to their actuarial goals by taking less risk or less beta, if you will. And so our performance is high single-digit, low double-digit over the last 10 years with relatively low volatility. And so I think we've been able to justify that. But we did shift our model. I often talk about hedge fund of funds 3.0. in the sense that we're viewing ourselves more like a multi-strat now. We look at the macro environment, rather than trying to hug the index like some of our peers. You know, the typical fund of funds got a bad rap because they weren't doing the due diligence. And then they'd give you 50 managers, they'd give you 2% in each of those managers, and you'd be hugging the index on your way to mediocrity. What we've tried to do is we've tried to concentrate our portfolio on things that we think are working. We have a dynamic approach where we will move out of securities or move out of hedge funds quickly if we think the market environment has changed. And we believe in concentration. So the top 10 managers for us, Steve, are about 65% of the assets. And I think that's differentiated us from our peer group. One last point, if you don't mind me making it, is that if I'm giving $1 billion out to somebody, if SkyBridge is giving out $1 billion, we're asking for fee concessions. And so we pass those on to our investors. So even though we have all these loaded fees, so to speak, we're giving back 75, 80 basis points a year in fee concessions, which I think is meaningful.
You mentioned performance. What is your 10-year performance?
It's about 9.8% over the last 10 years. But let me start.
That's net of fees.
Net of fees. But let me start with our worst year, which was 2008. We were down 19.9%. So that was a painful year for us. Our domestic fund.
So I have to ask the setup question.
Yes.
What was the S&P down that year?
62. Well, we both, it was a horrible year. So in that case, the relative performance is okay, but we both know you can't eat relative performance. And I got all my money in this fund, so I can tell you that was a very painful year for us.
You mentioned macro 12 to 18 months. What do you see the next 12 to 18 months?
I think you're going to see the Fed be more aggressive on the easing side than people anticipate.
So the end of the taper is not the end of quantitative easing?
I don't think so, sir. I think you're going to see a lot of a very friendly Federal Reserve policy over the next 18 months. It has to do with the unemployment situation in the United States, the lack of wage growth. And I think it also has to do with the fact that they're very, very nervous. If they raise rates, it'll pop the asset reflation story that they've built so far. And they think that would have a negative consequence on consumption. And so I'm in the camp that they're going to stay out there longer than they probably, you or I, would want them to. At some point, we'd like to have a natural return to the markets, a natural return to price discovery. They're manipulating the markets, let's face it.
Any sign to you that the Fed has made any connecting of the dots with what they've done and what's happened to the economy?
I,
the economy's done poorly precisely because of what the Fed has done.
Yeah, well, I think, again, any time in a free market society when you are manipulating markets, you're going to cause a distortive effect. Okay, there's a lot of famous economists that have written about this, but there are two things that are going on in the marketplace right now. Number one, People are waiting for that shoe to drop, for rates to come up, and so they've got a lot of fuel on reserve. Look at the S&P 500, $2 trillion of cash on the balance sheet of the S&P because of that worry. The second thing is that most Americans are fearing a tax increase. And so when you have a society like that, you have another tendency to depress your consumption. So you see the GDP numbers like I do. Now, they had a 4-plus percent print last quarter, but those numbers are really in the 2 zone. And I'll argue all day long that we're in a statistical recession, Steve. If you got 1.1% population growth, 2% productivity, the economy just treading water should be at a 3% number. We've been below that for the last 5 or 6 years. So I think you and I share that view that this has to end and there has to be a right sizing of the markets.
You're unusual among hedge fund managers in the sense of you want to have hedge funds for the masses, so to speak.
Yeah.
Your threshold is what, $25,000?
Yeah, we have a $25,000 minimum. I would say it's more for what we call the mass affluent as opposed to the masses, because we have to have this.
$1 million.
Yeah, exactly. There's a threshold. But I'm a big believer. I wouldn't say that I'm a populist, but I'm sort of a populizer. You know, I grew up in a middle class family. I think these managers do an exemplary job, at least the good ones do. And I often say to people rhetorically, why can't my mom and dad have the opportunity to get access to these sorts of brilliant managers? If it's good enough for Yale and it's good enough for Harvard, it's not good enough for CalPERS, but that's a different story. But for me, I want to get my folks the best money managers in the world, and that's one of the reasons why we've gone in this direction.
And so how does it break down now between individuals, affluent individuals, and in institutional investors?
Well, if you asked me that 2 years ago, I would have said it was 60 on the high net worth side, 40 on the institutional side. It's about 55 now on the institutional side, 45 on the individual. And so why have we seen that change? We've had consistently good performance. We've attracted a lot of institutions. And institutions, Steve, they don't invest in $25,000 slugs. You know, they come in with nine-figure chunks of money, which is created that differential.
That's one way you've been somewhat disruptive. What other ways? You say you like disruptive
I like disruptive people like you. I mean, I like thinking a little bit outside the box. One of the things that I've tried to do for the industry, taking some flack for it, is I would like to reduce the opaqueness in the industry. I think the more transparency that we have as a group, the more humanizing we can be. And the less demonized we can be by others. And so the SALT conference is an example of that, creating this 40-Act fund.
Now your SALT conference is a conference you've put together. You're now doing it in Singapore as well.
Yeah, we've had two times in Singapore, six times in Vegas.
Conference?
Well, it originally started at the bottom of the market. President Obama said in February 2009, now's not the time to go to Las Vegas. If you've got a private aircraft, land your private aircraft. I think he scared the bejesus out of all of those TARP recipients, and so they started canceling their conferences in the city of Las Vegas. One of my partners, Victor Oviedo, came in to me and said, hey, we should throw a conference in Vegas. I thought, frankly, he was nuts. And then he said, listen, there's a huge vacuum. It's the bottom of the market. We're either going out of business, it'll be a farewell party, or we'll be able to say that we caught the bottom of the market. And so I called Oscar Goodman, who was the mayor at the time. Steve, he should have been on the Secret Service watch list. I mean, he was pretty upset with the president over what was going on out there. But we went out to see Steve Wynn. We did our first one in the Encore Hotel. We had about 500 people. But it wasn't until the second year that we got more aggressive. We hired President Clinton to come out there. I got Governor Romney to come out there, as I'm a big supporter of the governor's. And then it built nicely into about a 2,000-person event. And again, it's open to the media. Your team has been out there. We've had television broadcast teams out there. And again, it's trying to humanize our industry, try to offer some economic value to pension funds, high net worth individuals, state treasurers, et cetera.
Have you been audited yet because of defying the president?
The audit, well, yes, unfortunately. let's put it this way. When you're in our industry, you're a target.
Right.
And if you have a big mouth in our industry, the bullseye is a little bit bigger.
You mentioned earlier, and I want to get into your approach right now about event-driven and define it, but begin by saying every 30 years, corporate America needs a shake-up.
Yeah.
And give us a little background on that and what the shake-up you see happening now.
Well, you know, I didn't learn an awful lot at Harvard Law School, but there were two things that I learned. Number one, avoid lawsuits at all costs.
Obviously, you've recovered from that education.
I did, yeah. I'm a recovering lawyer for sure. But the thing I really left an impression on me was Dean Clark, who became the Harvard Law School dean, was our corporations professor, and he said that the corporate income taxes have to be reformed every generation. Because as you know, because you're a flat tax advocate, as am I, but as you know, when you have the reform, then you get what we call the layering effect. The Congress goes out and layers thousands and thousands of pages of code onto the old reform. And so he said, if you don't go every generation with a reform, you get the situation which we have today, where the CEO is as focused on avoiding taxes as they are making stuff. And so we're seeing that now. I think what the president is doing is outrageous, frankly, him and Secretary Liu. This whole thing to prevent the inversions is changing the goalposts once again. You know, I think I mentioned this to you one time ago that I went to law school with the president. I'll confess, because it's part of my Catholic upbringing, that I did support him the first time because I knew him personally. But he lost my support in 2009 when he abrogated 800 years of contract law in the General Motors dispute, where he basically went to the creditors and said, look, you got to take a different deal. He gave more to the unions. The creditors said, well, wait a minute, we don't have to take that deal. He said, oh, yes, you do. The federal government's putting money in here. And those fixed income holders said, well, we don't need that money. We can just auction off these assets and restructure the company. And I think when you change the law and you change legal precedent, particularly contract precedent, you're adding risk premium to investments. Foreigners take good notice of that, Steve. And so if we don't get corporate tax reform, you're going to see a lot more tax avoidance schemes going on. And that's going to be depressive on the economy. Good for activists, though.
And then in terms of the 30 years, you mentioned the junk bonds in the 1980s.
Yeah.
What do you see unfolding now?
Well,
and then explain how Dodd-Frank actually, instead of empowering mom and pop, is empowered activists.
Absolutely.
So, big shareholders like Carl Icahn.
Well, let's talk about that. So Carl was in that junk bond space in the 80s, and you had the junk bond activism where you were getting the corporate reform that way. You either were going to be less of a fat cat CEO, or Henry Kravis, or Carl Icahn, or pick one of those guys who's going to come in and buy your company and restructure it for you. And they used Michael Milken's junk bond financing to do that. Today is a different story. You're getting activists. And so what happened here is in the Dodd-Frank legislation, Steve, there's about 90 pages of the 2,200 pages that are dedicated to minority shareholder rights. The interesting thing about that is I think that the intent was to help the mom-and-pop shareholders against the big, bad, ugly CEO and his corporate board, if you will. But that didn't happen because mom-and-pops typically don't want to exercise those rights. But what they did do is they empowered about 15 billionaire hedge fund managers with these minority shareholder provisions. One good example, Carl Icahn, he can write a letter to Tim Cook. He can own only 1.6% of the asset of Apple. He can call Tim Cook and say, I want a share repurchase. I want a dividend increase. Tim now has to respond to him. He's regulatorily required to do that. Barry Rosenstein, a great friend of mine, I'll disclose to your viewers that we're an investor of his. He's got a 1.3% position in Walgreens. The CEO gave him 3 board seats for that. Okay, so you didn't see that back in the 80s or the 90s, where these activists can take smaller and smaller stakes, but because they've been empowered by the doctrine of unintended consequences in the regulatory framework, they can use that as influence. And so our prediction is that the activists, we're probably in, and use another baseball expression, we're probably in the third inning of what we see to be heavy activism coming in the next 5 years.
So in terms of the percentage of assets you have, how much are in what you might call event-driven?
Yeah, we've got about 45% now. So we brought down that mortgage-backed exposure. That's probably in the low 20s, down from the 45% number. You'll see SkyBridge be a thematic investor. Again, we're looking at that dashboard, looking at where the opportunities are to make money without taking on too much incremental risk. Activism's got 3 things going for it. What we just mentioned, corporate tax reform, the regulatory framework, and there's a ton of cash on the S&P 500 balance sheet. These companies are going to act with that cash at some point, and that means there'll be a lot of merger activity which we can take advantage of for our investors.
This gets to another area, what you might call upward direction of the stock market. Mm-hmm. Explain how you're trying to take advantage of that.
Well, listen, I think the Federal Reserve monetary policy is going to push the market up. It looks fairly valued to slightly overvalued, but with interest rates at zero, there's really not an awful lot of places to go for people. So large pensions are still tactically asset allocating into the market. And so one of the things that we've been doing is we've been investing in people like a Lee Cooperman, where we're taking advantage of what we think is more long bias hedge fund managers. And I frankly, hopefully you'll hold me to it, you'll invite me back. I think the market's going to be up 10 to 15% in the next 12 months. And it'll be mostly born from the monetary policy, less so from the strength of the economy.
Breaking it down a little bit, will it be more of the large caps, which is what you get in a later bull market?
Yeah, absolutely. So we would say that the large cap U.S.-centric companies are the ones that we think are going to do the best. United States, for all of our problems, we're still the greatest capitalist engine in the world, and those companies are well positioned. One negative of the monetary policy, which I think you've actually even addressed, is that we're letting the companies borrow at these super low rates, and what are they doing with the money? They're investing it outside of the United States. You know, the Walmart did that big bond offering, and then they took the proceeds and they put it into South Africa. And so one of the ironies of the Federal Reserve policy is that these guys are borrowing at low rates and they're redeploying it outside of the United States. You've also got the tax differential going on, where we probably need to come up with a repatriation idea to bring the trillion plus dollars back onto the shore. But we'll be taking advantage of that as well. You know, I'm a big believer in dealing with the world the way it is, not the way we want it to be, Steve.
You mentioned how the Federal Reserve is giving you a huge opportunity in this upward area.
Yep.
Another one is the so-called Volcker Rule, which they probably never finalize.
Yep.
You make an interesting point that it took the banks out of the hedge fund business.
Well, so the irony of that is that they're trying to make the banks more stable. They certainly don't want the banks to take a depositor that they're giving a toaster to put that in the high-risk assets. But what it does do is it widens spreads. You have to remember, any time that the government is forcing you out of a market or into a market, they're manipulating prices. Look at the Fannie and Freddie situation. More and more people going into home ownership manipulated those prices. They're doing it in the reverse now in the hedge fund and the proprietary trading businesses, where they're widening spreads, they're removing players from the market, which is ironically very good for the hedge fund industry, because those people are migrating into our industry and they can take advantage of that spread widening. And so the Volcker Rule, again, doctrine of unintended consequences, is having a positive effect on our industry. I don't think anybody who wrote the Volcker Rule, including Chairman Volcker himself, wanted that to happen, Steve.
Your outlook then on credit markets?
I think the consensus is that rates are going up. I'm biased towards rates going down. The consensus is that we're going to have inflation. I sort of feel like we still have a specter of deflation upon the world, less so in the United States, but certainly in Japan and possibly in Europe. Most Americans, Steve, do not know how to handle deflation because you, myself, our parents grew up in an inflationary environment. But I got to tell you, deflation is the worst thing that can happen to an industrial economy because of the, we're holding so much debt. If we have to pay that debt back with dollars that are worth more than the ones we borrowed, well, that'll be a cataclysm for the economy.
Subject for another time, but the Fed, ironically, has been deflationary rather than inflationary.
It absolutely has, and you've written about this, and so then they put themselves in a tight box. They have a deflationary policy going on, and so they keep the rates low because they think that's going to defend them against the deflation. So it's a very, very difficult box. I will say this, though. There was a period from 2009, possibly into 2010, where you needed this sort of monetary accommodation to reduce the fear in the society. I do think that was necessary. Where we are today, though, I think is we've gone too far.
So how are you taking advantage of going against the high rate consensus, higher rate consensus?
So a lot of structured credit, still in the mid-20s for SkyBridge. This would include residential mortgage-backed securities, those credit-sensitive things that we were talking about. They used to be the old subprime. They're still cheap on a technical and fundamental basis. We are in the prepayment-sensitive space. Remember how prepayment, these interest-onlys work. If rates go up or they stay where they are, you won't see a lot of refinancings. Okay, and so we're in that space as well. We think that's going to be very ripe for the next 12 months.
Wall Street Week, one of the great iconic
I gotta get you
programs.
On yeah.
You're bringing back.
Yeah.
One is, why do you think there's space for it? Some will say in this age of handhelds and the like, who needs it?
Yeah.
And number two, you're known to be on CNBC, but you've been talking to Fox.
Yeah.
How do you do that?
Well, no, okay, so I actually signed with Fox, and basically, so I'm, and I see you on there regularly on the weekends,
on the
Saturday morning block. Yeah, so I basically, I think CNBC, frankly, got a little sore at me that I bought the Wall Street Week franchise, and so they sort of put me in a penalty box, which was fine. But I went to go see Roger Ailes, who I know you have a great relationship
yes.
with. I spent over an hour with him and laid out our strategy with Wall Street Week. I also got a lot of friends over there. Maria Bartiromo, I think you and I both have a close relationship with. Maria left CNBC last year. And so I signed with Fox. I'm going to be a contributor on their shows. And I'm not saying that Wall Street Week will be on Fox yet. I think that's premature to say that. But come the early part of the winter, January, February, we'll be making an announcement on Wall Street Week. Love to get you on the show. We own the film library. We own the Twitter feed, the Facebook page, the old logo. And I think, yes, there's an inundation of product. And yes, we're in this new world, which we're both having to deal with today. But I think information. I think the way we're getting the information and the distribution vehicle is different, but the reason why Forbes is going to be successful over the next 15 years is the high quality content. And so I'm a big believer if we can develop a half hour or an hour show that has high content, a lot of economic discussion, a lot of what's going on in the world and how to capitalize on it, I think there'll be viewers. It may be on Netflix, but we'll find them.
On the personal side,
yeah.
Especially with younger people, you've provided some very useful lessons. One is you don't know where you're going until you find it.
Yeah, there's no question about that. Well, you're talking about somebody who I went to law school because my dad was a laborer.
Well, you mentioned a very telling statistic. You said your father never earned more than $41,000 a year in construction. This was years ago.
Yeah.
And you read that starting lawyers, if they got into one of the top firms, over $60,000 a year.
Yeah, you got a good memory. Yeah. So, my dad actually went on to make a little bit more than that. But in the mid-80s, his salary was in that zone. And so when they were saying $65,000 for starting salary, Steve, at the age of 21, I thought that was more money than I would ever want or need in my life. And so I went directly to the law school career route. Unfortunately, I didn't like the law. I ended up at Goldman, a great firm, but down deep, I always wanted to be an entrepreneur.
And tell us, you got fired.
I did, yeah. I got fired from my first job. I was one of those kids, precocious and insecure. I needed to go to that cocktail party at Harvard Law School, which is a very famous one, at the end of school. You walk around and you tell your peers where you're going to go work. And the best job or the hottest job at that time in the late 80s was Goldman Sachs, investment banking, and I also liked real estate. So I was in Goldman Sachs, investment banking, and the real estate department. The trouble with that, Steve, is I wasn't any good at any of those things. I didn't have the spreadsheet training or the analytical training. And so about 18 months after I'd gotten that job, I was fired, which was one of the more painful experiences of my career. I did write about it a lot because I think it's important to tell younger people you can have some fits and starts in your career. Things could not go necessarily the way you're planning. We want our lives to be on a 45-degree slope, but what do we know about markets and our lives? They're cyclical, and they go on a jag more than a slope. And so it's important for us to just stay the course, remain optimistic, and be open to new opportunities. So the irony there, though, is I ended up getting rehired by Goldman into the sales area. This is a cute part of the story. They gave me an $11,000 severance check, and they told me good luck finding a job. when I found a job at Goldman, the personnel department called me and said, hey, we're going to give you good news. We're not going to mark you down as fired. We're going to say that you were interdepartmentally transferred. I said, okay, that's great. So, can we get the $11,000 check back? I said, well, I've already spent it. I can't give it back to you. But in fairness to Goldman, they still marked me down as intercompany transfer. So, you know, it's a great organization. They had a great culture. You remember John Weinberg from the old days. This was a guy that had some great expressions. One I'll never forget is that some people, Steve, some people grow, but other people swell. I thought that was one of the more beautiful lines that John said about life. You know, you keep yourself together and stay grounded.
Sometimes good things happen in spite of ourselves.
Right, exactly.
Tell us the story about Lehman Brothers, how you were forced to sell the stock.
Well, that's also another interesting twist in my career. I was super confident about Lehman and the direction of Lehman. But again, because of my entrepreneurial bug, I wanted to leave. And so when I left in March of 2005, I petitioned the firm to allow me to keep my options and the stock associated with my sale of my first company. And so they said to me, you had to go before this personnel board and they would review it. And I made the claim that I wasn't going to be at a competitor. And Lehman actually had an investment in our fund and I had a good relationship. And they said, yeah, you got to sell your stock. And so I was forced to sell in April of 2005 in the 40s. Lehman Brothers, if you recall, went from 40 to about $89 a share. I was trying to stab one of my eyeballs out, Steve, with like a butter knife. I was so upset at that move. And then, of course, we know in September of 2008, Lehman became the largest bankruptcy in history. So I like telling students this story because it's a case of what you know, what you think you know with great certainty. And sometimes the things that you think you know with great certainty, that Lehman was going to $300 a share, is in fact something you don't know at all. And so it builds the case for diversification. It builds the case for rechecking your analysis. And one of the things I always say to our guys at SkyBridge, let's relitigate this portfolio with the assumption that we're wrong about a lot of the things that we're thinking.
Good story on that was Howard Hughes back in the 1950s when he's head of TWA, which was then the second largest airline, one of the largest airlines in the world. And unfortunately, he was losing his facilities then. And he went out and bought a bunch of jet aircraft because he thought that was the future. But he just went bonkers on it. So the directors got him removed and forcibly had him sell the stock,
wow,
which turned out to be the high, $86 a share.
There you go.
And he was furious, but he got several hundred million, and we all know what happened to TWA. Wow.
You see, so I mean, sometimes you create some of your own luck, but God, all of us entrepreneurs know that a lot of our success is providential.
Now, talking about providential, one final question. You have a little piece of the Mets.
Yes.
Which has been character building for fans in the recent years.
It's been very painful,
is
Steve.
Is Providence going to help them next year?
Well, you know, I
is management going to get some good players?
Well, you know, listen, we've got great pitching. We've got a shortage of hitters. But I do, I am a fan of Jeff and Fred Wilpon. I know they take a lot of flack from the other fans, but I know the guys personally. And so when they invited me into the partnership a few years ago with Jim McCann from 1-800-Flowers, I readily accepted. I'm a diehard fan. It's been very painful. I've often tweeted out on my Twitter handle, why do I care so much? But I watch these games even when they don't matter. But I do think next year we're going to be okay because we've got Harvey coming back. We've got DeGrom. My guess is they'll get us a good power hitter in the outfield.
No more predictions of 92 game win seasons.
Oh, man, that was a painful one. Yeah. Yeah, I think Sandy's regretting that that prediction.
Anthony, thank you.
Thank you. Enjoyed it very much. Thank you.